the high desert of Israel, which is really, really nice. Before I start, of course, acknowledgement, some funding from the Adelis Foundation, the Israel Science Fund, and the BGU Energy Initiative. I was suggested to put a map of Israel because many people don't know how it looks like. So this is Israel. So the famous spots are probably Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. This is the Weizmann Institute, Bar Ilan University. This is Be'er Sheva, and this is the Technion. So this distance is about 2 hours drive. And that's all of the universities in Israel, pretty much. So Israel is very small. If you want to drive from Bangalore to Mumbai, you literally have to cross 3 times Israel on the long side. So Israel is very, very small. It's much, much smaller than India. But of course, it's a very beautiful place. Everybody is welcome to stay, to come. And I initially wanted to talk about the things that I do in the context of thermal transport, because this is the majority of the audience in the crowd. But eventually, being mostly a quantum transport person, and since I'm very excited with these recent things that I'm doing, so I'm not going to be talking about that. But please ask me about transport in DNA, and specifically DNA is a balls and spring kinds of model with nonlinear springs. There are a lot of interesting stuff. And please ask me about mapping thermal transport to Kremer's transition rate theory. And there are also interesting things here. I will be here till Friday, so if you are interested, definitely ask me. What I do want to talk to you about is kind of make an introduction to a field which is almost roughly known as quantum biology. And the reason it's relevant to this program is really because everything in biological systems is always very far from equilibrium. There's nothing there that goes on which is even close to equilibrium, otherwise nothing would live. There are always processes going on, which makes it an interesting system for statistical physics in general and for transport properties specifically. So I will give a long introduction into this quantum biology. I will show you the motivation to what we are doing, and then I will describe our theory and thinking about power and efficiency and things like that, and summarize and conclude. So let's start. Really, quantum biology is the search for non-trivial quantum effects in biological systems, right? So this, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Erwin Schrödinger. There are a lot of applied mathematicians in the crowd. So he's a famous guy in the quantum community. No, I'm kidding. And in 1944, he wrote a book, and the book is called What is Life? And he gives his thoughts about how biological systems work, and it's really a book in statistical mechanics, or in thermodynamics. And he specifically states that quantum effects are not important in biological systems, really. And when we say quantum effects, we don't mean the orbitals of the molecules. Of course, that's always there, but that's not really essentially quantum mechanical in the strange meaning of the word. What we really mean is effects of interference and effects of coherence, right? These are the manifestations of quantum mechanics which cannot be explained by classical dynamics. And this is what we are looking for. And in recent years, there have been various candidates to systems which are biological, but they use quantum coherent dynamics or at least partially coherent dynamics in order to get function, to make things better for the biological creature that uses them. One example is olfaction, which is the biologist's word for smelling. And the idea is that we don't know how it works. And one of the competing theories is that we have receptors in our noses which react to the vibrations of the molecules, but not to the chemical structure of the molecules. So you have a donor, electrons moving from one side to the other, and they're moving coherently through the molecule, and they feel the vibrational frequencies of the molecule, and this way they can distinguish between different molecules. This is one theory. Another quite famous idea is avian navigation. And the idea is that this guy, the European robin, flies about 4,000 kilometers from Norway to North Africa. And we don't know how he does it. Now, other migratory birds have a little magnets in their beaks, right? Like pigeons, they have magnetite in their beaks, but this guy does not have magnetite in his beak. There's nothing in his beak. And it turns out he cannot navigate at night. And it turns out that if you put it in a cage and you apply magnetic fields with various frequencies, the guy gets disoriented completely. So the mechanism that we're thinking about, not me, but the community, is that he has this molecule called cryptochrome in his eye, on his retina. When you shine light on a cryptochrome, you generate a radical pair, which is basically a spin singlet. And in the presence of a magnetic field, this spin singlet kind rotates, and some of it is transformed into a spin triplet. And the chemistry of singlet and triplets are very different. So by the amount of triplet chemistry produced on the retina, he can infer what is the magnetic field of the of his latitude or where he is. And this is kind of the idea. Of course, this is there are some details involved, but this is kind of general idea. There is an issue here, because in order to make this transition coherent, you need coherence times which are about 1,000, about 3 orders of magnitude larger than what is expected in this system. So that's, we don't know yet. And the third system is a photosynthesis, which is the kind of the central thing that I'm looking at. And I will, of course, show you the evidence for quantum coherence in photosynthesis. So let me just say a few things about photosynthesis, although we all know it kind of from grammar school. So this is, photosynthesis is basically the process by which plants make food. They take sunlight, they take oxygen, and they take CO2, and they generate oxygen, and they make their own food, sugars eventually, through some chemical process. And there are a few things I want you to know about photosynthesis which are relevant, because this is, of course, a statistical mechanics thing. First of all, photosynthesis is very, very, very old. It's it's an extremely old process. So I don't know if you know this picture. It's the cosmic calendar. If you put the time from the Big Bang to today on a calendar, then World War II, for example, was 0.2 seconds ago. It was on December 31, 1159 and 58 seconds. This was World War. Humans appeared somewhere in the last hour of the calendar, but photosynthesis roughly appeared in October 3rd. So that's about 3 billion years ago. And it hasn't changed much, which means that photosynthetic systems are really, really good at what they're doing. And what they are doing, and this is the second point, is that basically what they are doing is converting solar energy into a chemical energy. So they're basically heat engines. You have a temperature difference between the Earth and the Sun, and they use this temperature difference to generate chemical energy. And people have looked at it in this way of thinking, about it really as a continuous heat engine. So that's what they do. The third thing, which is more of an anecdote, but it will lead us to the system that I'm thinking about, is that when we think about photosynthesis, we typically think about, you know, trees and the Amazon rainforest and things like that. The truth is that most of the photosynthesis actually occurs at the oceans via this guy, the phytoplankton, which is basically a small algae. And these are responsible for any number between 50 and 85% of the world's oxygen. So that's just a fact. And the fact is that not only algae, but also some bacteria use photosynthesis to make food. And this is the example, and the reason it's the example is that this is the fruit fly of photosynthetic research. It's the smallest and simplest photosynthetic architecture that has been mapped, at least that I know of. So this is one of the geyser holes in Yellowstone, and the red, the green thing that you see inside the hole is really the reflection from a bacteria called the green sulfur bacteria. And it lives in these kind of places, also in some lakes in Indonesia and so on. And really it's the simplest system. This is how it looks like. And pretty much all photosynthetic systems have generally the same structure. They have an antenna because they have to collect sunlight somehow, right? And this is, of course, optimized for the solar spectrum and so on. They have this membrane, and on the membrane they have the reaction center. This is where the chemical reaction takes place. An electron jumps into an ATP molecule, all things start to get chemical. I don't want to talk about it, of course. And in between, there is something called the transfer networks, exciton transfer networks. These are these blue guys called FMO. That's the Fenn-Matthew Olson transfer networks. They are specific for this bacteria. And these are the guys who actually transfer the energy that was collected in the antenna into the reaction center. And these are the guys which are mostly responsible for the efficiency of the photosynthetic process. So this is how they look like, right? It's some proteins. So let me enlarge this. So this trimer has three of these monomers. Each one of them has this giant protein backbone. We don't care about that. And in between, there is really a network of these molecules called bacteriochlorophylls. There's some magnesium inside and all kinds of carbons and hydrogens. But really what we have here is a network, right? A small network of seven sides, but in larger systems and in higher plants, this will become a network of much, much larger number of sides. And energy comes into one side and flows out of the other. Right? So already we can see the relation to non-equilibrium transport. This is happening very, very far from equilibrium. The sunlight is pushing excitons, which are the carriers of energy in the systems. These are just electron hole excitations inside the molecules. And they talk to each other via dipole-dipole moment, and the Hamiltonian describing the system has been characterized experimentally. So we know, to some extent, the Hamiltonian, we know how to write the Hamiltonian for this kind of exciton transfer network. And you see, this is just a simple tight binding Hamiltonian. There's nothing special about it. Excuse? Yeah. So, yes, so each number, I'm 7 or 8, because sometimes if there's a chemist in the crowd, they will tell you, no, the FMO has 8 sites. So, well, that depends on how you interpret experiments. Sometimes there are 7 sites, sometimes there are 8 sites. But you really, there's just these the energies of the local excitons, right? And the energy of the local exciton is defined by its environment and by whatever. And there is coupling between the different excitons. And this is dipole-dipole interaction. So the angles of how these molecules are sitting really defines the magnitude of these numbers. So now in 2007, Engel and co-workers did the following experiment. They shine light on this guy. And they do it four consecutive times. And this is kind of an elaborate pump probe method. Basically, what you do when you shine light, you excite the first exciton. They shine light in the specific parts, they excite the exciton. And then they shine it again. So whether or not you excite an exciton depends on the population of the ones you already excited, right? So this kind of tells you what is the population of the excitons. And when you apply these kind of series of pulses, you really know to map how energy flows inside between the different excitons. Of course, I'm not going to go into the details. These are very complicated experiments. But the bottom line of these experiments is that if you look at the, now you transform, Fourier transform TNT prime, you have an energy landscape, a two-dimensional energy landscape. And on the diagonals, you see energy absorbed and emitted from the same exciton because it's on the same energy, right? But if you have something that is occurring off diagonal, that means that energy moved from one point to the other, right? Because there was some loss of energy. And now they do this two-dimensional spectroscopy as a function of this time tau, right? And you see this off diagonal point is really changing as a function of this time tau. And if you map this point, you see these very nice, very clear oscillations, which go on for hundreds of femtoseconds, up to thousands of femtoseconds. Now, if you have a biological system, you excite something and you let it either diffuse or you let it decay, typically the decay is exponential. There is no backscattering, right? There is no oscillations. So this is considered to be at least evidence that this system is quantum coherent. Also, there is no vibration mode which is in this frequency. So this is the evidence for, and of course, this experiment has been repeated many, many times, right? These guys are very careful experimentalists. And in various systems, in different photosynthetic systems, in more complicated ones. So there is a body of evidence that indeed there is quantum coherence of this exciton moving inside the system. Now, there are three questions one must ask. First of all, is it real? I mean, is it really evidence of quantum coherence, or is it just a classical effect that we don't understand? Because the next question is, how is this, if it is quantum coherence, how can this be happening? This is a biological system. It's wet and floppy, right? It's in a liquid environment like every other cell in the plant's body. You know, everything is at room temperature. Everything is always moving. How do these systems maintain quantum coherence, which is a delicate effect? That's a hard question. The third question, oh, I have a typo. Does nature, if indeed one or two, you got the answers correct and you do have quantum coherence, is this a coincidence, or is nature using this quantum coherence to optimize the performance of photosynthetic systems? Now, just a caveat, when you say optimization, it means different things for different people, for different communities. For me, for people from transport, optimization means that you want to have, you know, the largest efficiency or largest power output. For biologists, optimization is all about stability. They say the plant cares more if he survives than if he's able to, you know, make it 15% efficient or 25% efficient. So there are different questions there to ask. So now let me dwell a little bit into the theory of how this is done. Let's assume that we answered questions one and two, and we are completely convinced that the system is quantum coherent, right? So this is how we would attack it. This is how it's been attacked in most of the theory papers. You write down the Hamiltonian, fine, right? Now you write down an environment. This is a local environment to each one of these chromophores, to each one of these exciton sites. And of course, everything is moving. And you couple each one of these excitons to its own environment, right? So you think about an electron hole pair jumping into this site, and now it feels all these vibrations from the molecular environment. Again, this is a wet and floppy environment. And this is characterized by some spectral function, right? So you know the details of this spectral density. And now you need to calculate something, right? That's what theorists do. And typically what is calculated is the local density is a function of time. So you excite an exciton at sites 1 of 6. These are the physical places where the exciton, where this network is actually connected to the antenna. So in real systems, excitation really happened here. So we do this coherently. You just start with the system where the density at site 1 and site 6 is 1 and the rest is 0, for example. And then you let the system evolve dynamically in the presence of environment, and you calculate how much of the excitation has reached to this site 3. Right? Really, you're calculating the number of excitons that were actually able to move from one side of the other. And this is what everybody calculates. It looks kind of like this. So you see, as a function of time and a function of parameters, you will get different answers. So this these three lines are kind of the population, how much of the excitation reached the site number three. Right? Yeah.
So the excitation, you basically excite one of the site and then see how the...
Yes, yes.
So that excitation is done by coherent light or incoherent?
Coherent light. This is one...
Sunlight is typically...
Naturally. So this is what people do. This is the vast majority of the calculations. And one of the most striking results of these calculations is that efficiency, in terms of this transfer efficiency, is enhanced in the presence of dephasing. So if the system is perfectly quantum, you will get one number. If the system is perfectly classical, so you only have classical dynamics, you would get some efficiency, but it is actually non-monotonic with a maximum in between. So some amount of quantum coherence really, or if you're on the other way around, some amount of dephasing actually helps the system. And the mechanism for that is still unclear. We know there are various suggestions, and you can see this is just a few reviews on the topic. So there's a lot of work going on there. And of course, one must ask, and what do we ask? You know, coming into a field which already has, you know, dozens of theoretical papers, one must present a new angle. So what we wanted to ask is, first of all, how is the thermodynamic efficiency? Because to us, efficiency is power out divided by power in, right? That's the standard definition of efficiency in thermodynamics. How is this efficiency and how is the power output behave as a function of the parameters of the system? For example, if you want the dephasing time, which is the average time it takes for a wave function to lose its phase and to gain some random phase. This is kind of the question. Second, once you get this behaving, is the performance better in the presence of dephasing, right? So we saw this thing for this transfer efficiency. Is it also the case for the power output? Right? And if it does, we want to know why. If it doesn't, we also want to know why. We want to understand what is the mechanism causing this. And we want to know, is it really related to this transfer efficiency of excitons? Now, I want to point out two things which are important here. One, electron transfer complex is an energy conversion device. Right? It's a heat engine. So there really is a sense in asking questions about thermodynamic efficiency and power output. And in fact, not much sense in asking questions about exciton numbers. And this has to do with the fact that excitons, which are not electrons, they do not carry charge. So if you have an electronic system, which is my background, things are much, much easier. Because you know exactly if you have current and you have a heat current, they are related in a very basic way, because these are the same guys who carry the heat and the current. But in excitons, these can be two separate currents. The exciton current and the heat current can behave very, very differently. So this is a point one needs to think about. And this leads me to the second part of the talk, which is what we try to do. And we try to take the account the source and the antenna to make things incoherent and in steady state, right? This is kind of like what nature does, right? You have a system when you pump it with incoherent light rather with coherent excitations, and you use the steady state, so you have incoherent, and we calculate directly the power output. So this is the FMO network. We push current through this through these two sites, and we extract current out of this side. We use the Lindblad equation. Now, the Lindblad equation is a quantum master equation, which has two very good advantages. One, it's always a positive, so it's a proper quantum equation. And second, it has a very, very simple interpretation. You just think about what the environment does to your system, and you plug it into the equation. Of course, the cause is a phenomenological theory, and it has no memory. It's fully Markovian. So it has its limitations, but at least to understand the situation, it's very easy, because now all we have to do is write down the so-called Lindblad operators, and you see all you do here is insert an excitation at site 1 and 6. You extract the excitation at site 3, with a given with given rates, gamma in and gamma out, and at each point you dephase the system. And you can think about this as some kind of local measurement that the vibrations are doing on the wave functions. And this is a very simple way of putting dephasing into system. Yes, sorry.
It's a very trivial question. I mean, C and
this one?
These are, I mean, your creation annihilation of a wave. Are these fermions or bosons? Or
So these are fermions. Excitons are fermions, are chargeless fermions, neutral fermions. They're spins. Actually, that really spins. You know, they're mapped exactly into spins. Yes, yes. I write them like this, but they're really spins.
So 1 and 6 are the places where the sunlight comes.
Yes.
And other sides
are just
the phonon vibrations.
Yes. Well, the phonon vibrations are everywhere. So this is the phonon vibration kind of. It's really a phenomenological dephasing, right? But this happens everywhere. On each one of the sites, because the compound is the same, but this guy is physically and now again one has to be careful. This is not where sunlight comes in. This is where these guys are connected to the antenna, so the excitation comes in from there, not directly sunlight. There's a slight difference, but it's definitely an incoherent excitation. Here, there's no temperature. You can roughly relate this number to a temperature. But no temperature here, strictly phenomenological. Now, I solved the steady state. The nice thing about this formalism is because the baths are physically separated, you can calculate directly the power output, the power that goes into your system and the power that goes out of your system. So you have everything you need to do calculations. So what I'm plotting here is the power output as a function of the dephasing rate and as a function of the injection rate, right? So you inject excitations at a given rate. There is some rate at which the wave functions lose their phase, and this is the power output, and you see there is a non-monotonic behavior, and this line is where the change is maximal. So this is kind of the optimal place that these systems would like to live in, and in fact, this is not very far from what are the estimations of realistic systems. So a few inverse picoseconds. So we already see this strange non-atonic behavior that if you are fully quantum or if you're fully classical, the power output is really, really, really bad because it's very hard for you to pass excitations. If you're fully quantum, okay, you have some number. But if you're partially quantum and you have dephasing, so you have some coherence time, you're actually increasing the efficiency. Okay, I don't want to talk about this. This is an interesting effect. This is the power input, right? So the system is pushing excitations into the system. It's like a father pushing his kid on the swing, right? But there is some optimal time and optimal dephasing in which the system can absorb the energy given to it by the bath, right? So this is already an interesting behavior because you cannot see this effect when you excite coherently. And this is the efficiency. The efficiency always decreases with dephasing, right? So if nature is trying to maximize something, it's power output rather than efficiency. Efficiency is always decaying with increasing dephasing. Now, this is a very robust effect. It holds even if you take the full trimer structure, even if you take different estimations of the structure of the FMO, even if you take roughly random kind of exciton networks, you will probably get that, and I will go in a second to the reason why this is. So I'm choosing this maximal line of power input, and again, I'm plotting the power output as a function of the phasing rate. Okay, dephasing, you can think about it as how quantum is the system, right? So this area is very non-quantum, fully classical dynamics, just rate equations. And this is fully quantum dynamics, no loss of phase inside the system. And somewhere in between on a log scale, you get the maximum. Now, this is the power input. This is the system's ability to actually extract heat from its environment, from the antenna. And this is what everybody else is calculating. This is the exciton current. And what you see is that the exciton current is related not to the power output, but rather to the power input. And in fact, it's pretty easy. In order to increase the power input, you need to have the two excitons, the two sites at the entry to be vacant, right? If they're occupied, you cannot excite them again, right? So you need to move excitons away from these guys quickly, and the quicker you do it, the better you pump energy into your system. But that tells you nothing about the power output of your system. You see, the maximum here is very, very far from the maximum in the power output. So it's really very different behaviors. The exciton current and the power output are very different things. And this is an important point. So why does this happen? Why is there at all a maximum in the power output? And I have 8 minutes, that's good. Okay? And of course, the question is, does and how it involves the geometry of the network? Because you see, this is a kind of a strange network. It's not, you know, some trivial line or a circle. There are various simpler things you could imagine, right? So how does this has to do with the structure of the network? So if you look at the structure of the network, you actually see that it kind of looks like two weakly connected branches, which I call the right branch and the left branch. And this left branch is also inside this kind of circle inside it. And this, everything is connected to everything, but the stronger connections are between these sides, this branch, and this branch. And in order to understand what's going on, we calculated the local heat currents. So really, the amount of energy per unit time flowing from one side to the other, right? And this is something you can do with this, within this formula quite easily. If you want to know how, you just go to Jira's paper. But it's something we can do with this formula. It's actually quite easy. There's no additional computational cost. And this is what one finds out. These guys, so I'm plotting here the local heat currents as a function of this dephasing rate, how much the system is quantum, for various sites. So you see these pale lines. This is site 6 and 7 and 1 and 2. So this is 1 and 2. This is 6 and 7. The important thing is that these pairs lie on the same branch, right? So they are on the same branch of the system. But if you look at pairs 2 and 5, for example, and 1 and 6, but you can do it for any other pair, you see a behavior which is dramatically different. Why is it dramatically different? Because the heat current starts when the system is fully quantum, it starts in one direction, and then at some magical dephasing point, it actually reverses its direction and goes the other way. So to start with, for example, heat flows from site 2 to 5, but then when you increase dephasing, at some point there is no heat flow at all between these points, and then heat starts flowing from 5 to 2. So it reverses its direction. And not only this happens at the same point, but also this is exactly the point where the power output is maximal. Right? So so the interbranch heat current vanishes at this optimal dephasing rate, but the intrabranch, of course, heat flows all the time because it's out of equilibrium, right? And it has nothing to do with densities. One might think, okay, maybe the occupations change, and so it's kind of diffusion, but the occupations do not change their number. So really what is going on is the following situation, right? And this will be probably my last, but this is the main point, right? Let's say you start with a fully quantum system. Then the only thing that really matters are the eigenfunctions and the eigenvalues of your system. This is how the system is really constructed. And now you pump energy into the system, you excite all these eigenfunctions, right? And you extract system, so you somehow mix these quantum eigenfunctions. And if you translate it to the local language, to the real space language, then you will have some local heat currents, which are defined by the relations between the eigenfunctions and the eigenvalues, Right? So that's everything that determines here. Now, if you go to the extreme limit, the extreme classical limit, really what you have here is a network of resistors. Right? These are thermal resistors, but still it's a network of resistors. So you have to solve something like Kirchhoff's laws, right? And you see this has the structure of kind of like a Wheatstone bridge. There are interconnections and so on. So the currents will be determined by the solution of these Kirchhoff's laws. And the point is that these, the solutions in the dephasing limit and the solution in the fully quantum limit do not have to be the same. In fact, they are not the same. And they do not have to have the same directions, right? They can have the opposite direction. What happens here is that the situation is such that the directions of heat that flows between the left and right branches are different between these two limits. On the dephasing limit, energy typically flows from this side to this side, and on the quantum limit, it typically flows from this side to this side. So somewhere in between, there is no heat flow between these two branches, and the heat is actually directed along the two branches, minimizing dissipation and leading to maximum power output. So this is the microscopic mechanism leading to this kind of maximal power output. And this is kind of nice because we can really see the microscopics, and you can actually, of course, this is a 7x7 matrix. You can actually plot the Hamiltonian and look at the wave functions and actually see it. But it's easier to see for a simple model. So if you look at a 3x3, a network with three sides, you can actually calculate everything analytically, and you take the vanishing dephasing limit. And this is also for the weak coupling limit, just to make things smaller. You see that you get, for example, the heat, the current that flows from 1 to 2 is one expression. And if you look at the strong dephasing limit, you get another expression. And these guys should not and do not have the same sign. So even in this very small network, you can actually see that in the limit of strong dephasing and limit of fully quantum, you have a change of sign in the local heat currents. And this is explained, this maximum, and again, you see the heat current vanishes at some maximal number. I will not go into the details. Two more points. This actually happens also if you excite it with a pulse excitation. Rather than continuously pulsing, pumping via the Lindblad equations, you excite it with a pulse excitation, you actually see the dynamics, but the behavior is exactly the same. So this is quite a general phenomenon. It has to do with the structure of the system rather than the way it's coupled to the environment. Two more things I want to point out. One, this is roughly the spectral function of these bacteriophiles. So this has been mapped experimentally and theoretically. And this is the broadband contribution, which is what I mimic with this dephasing time. But it also has a localized vibrational mode. The chemists call it the 180 inverse centimeters vibration mode. They have these strange units. I'm not sure why they use them. So so we already know that these guys, this flat dephasing rate assists efficiency. So we wanted to know what does this localized phonon does, and without going into the details, the answer is that it ruins the power output. And one last thing that I want to say is about this stability, and we can calculate, for example, what happens to the power output when you chop one of the links, if you damage the photosynthetic network. And not going into details, this black line kind of tells you what happens to the efficiency when you chop a line on average as a function of dephasing, and the answer is not much, right? So the conclusion from this line, and this is something one should take, is that if one thinks about it seriously, this network structure, complicated network structure, really evolved to enhance the stability, right? Of course, if you have just a line and you chop it in the middle, you will have zero power output. So obviously having two branches is much more stable than having one branch, right? Because if you chop one branch out of the two, you will still have power output, right? And then on top of that, the system parameters evolve that given this kind of structure, you will have optimal power output. This is kind of the way that I would like to think about it. So just to summarize, this is a new kind of way of thinking about heat of excitonic and photosynthetic in general in terms of power output, thinking like a heat engine rather than exciton transport. And thinking about that, we see that there is some optimal dephasing time where power output is maximal. And this has to do with directing the power only through the branches of the system and not through the interbranch, which is related to the structure of the system. So there is a direct relation between this dephasing rate and the structure of the system. And this is pretty much it. Thank you for attention. And let me thank the organizer. Look, it's blinking as we speak. 40 minutes sharp.
Okay, so one question. Yeah.
It's a Born approximation.
It's even more than that. It's a Born Markov approximation.
Exactly, Born Markov. Mm-hmm. There is this Born approximation. So basically, it's perturbative in the coupling. So you have the system and you have two baths. It's perturbative in the coupling between the system and the bath. So will this capture the resonance effects? So for example, if you have a similar system, which is, let's say, a quantum dot connected to reservoirs. Now, if it's a non-interacting quantum dot, then if you send in...
Yes, of course, the answer is no. It does not capture the resonance effects.
Yeah.
But within these parameters, actually, the coupling to the environment is actually small.
Okay.
So that's not too bad for these systems. And this is kind of the standard approach to go about in these kind of calculations, because these rates are very small. One must understand that the average occupation number of excitons inside the system is about 0.1. So it's really very weakly coupled to the antenna.
Okay.
But definitely one of the things that we want to do is take a step back from Lindblad, go into Redfield, and then go even further back. And people have done that, but not in the context of power output. So we don't know really what would be the effect of taking into account, really, for example, the dynamics of the vibrations, what will that do to the power output? My suspicion is that this kind of phenomena is general, right? But of course, this is just intuition and not calculation, and this has to be done at some point.
Okay. Another broader remark, that is, because this is some sort of electronic system, has someone done some sort of interference experiment? So put this in a high magnetic field and then there should be this.
This is not an electronic system, it's an excitonic system.
Okay.
These are much, much harder to do transport experiments. People are trying to do transport experiments, but these are optical transport experiments. So you shine light on one side and you capture it from the other side. This is not really what we're used to plugging electrodes and things like that.
Yeah.
So these are much more complicated systems in that sense. But people are trying to do, I can give you references later, to some experiments that are trying to do that.
Okay, time is already up, so let's move to the next talk. It's time to speak again.